Yeah, so as he mentioned, my name is Huzaifa. I'm going to talk a little bit about the security of open source, or you know, rather what most people say, the insecurity of open source. So before I start, a few words about myself. I work as a principal product security engineer at Red Hat. I'm a part of various open source projects out there. I work closely with Mozilla, LibreOffice, Python, PHP, Samba, Xorg, and a couple of other projects as well. Probably some of them I don't even remember right now. I have been a Fedora contributor for the past 8 years. I have been doing various things. I maintain a couple of security packages. I have been doing a lot of speaking at conferences in the last 2 or 3 years. And in most of the conferences, I've been trying to speak about open source and, you know, why open source is secure as compared with the closed source counterpart. So this is a real short talk, and I want to convince all of the attendees that, you know, open source is really secure. And in the last 2 or 3 years, if you have ever heard of Heartbleed, how many people have heard of Heartbleed? So if you have heard of Heartbleed, or if you have heard of Shellshock, or, you know, if you have heard of any other things like that, a lot of these security flaws has led people and enterprises to think that, you know, open source is where most of the flaws are found, and, you know, we should probably go back to the closed source counterpart. And I will try to convince you guys that, you know, open source is really the way to go. So why are we interested in security bugs? Why are security bugs so important? All software has bugs. So, you know, if you have used any software, be it a Windows, or, you know, if you have used any open source software, or, you know, if you have been using your mobile phones or your tabs or something like that, your iOS, all of these softwares have bugs. You may have encountered that, you know, you try to do something with WhatsApp, or, you know, you try to open an image in a browser and it will crash or something like that. That's probably when you hit a bug in the software. The bigger the software, the more larger is the bug, the more the number of bugs you can find. So a very good example is the LibreOffice project. The LibreOffice project, last I checked, I think has got 3.5 million lines of code. It's a combination of C, Python, Perl, Java, and whatnot, right? Mozilla is a large code base as well. The kernel is the biggest code base, I think. 1.5 billion lines of code, mainly C, assembly. You need to be a real nerd to really understand what is going on in there. If you have ever looked at OpenSSL code, you'll probably need a PhD in mathematics, because it's a combination of weird C programming, assembly language, different optimizations for different compilers out there, and a lot of things which only the writer will basically understand. So it's really complicated. And we use this complicated software everywhere. I think 60% of internet uses OpenSSL. Not only the open source people, but even a lot of closed source softwares compile against OpenSSL, they embed OpenSSL. Probably more than 60%. A lot of people use Firefox, Google Chrome, right? Google Chrome is a big beast as well. Last time I checked, it embedded 35 libraries inside it, right? So these are libraries which are openly available. So, you know, when you click on your web page, say google.com, and you want to see an image, your Google Chrome uses libpng or libjpeg or libtiff to probably render that library onto your browser. So each library you embed inside your software, the more is the risk of a bug, or the more is the risk of the security bug, right? So we are basically using software which has large code bases out there, from kernel to, you know, web browsers to, you know, our web servers. All of these have extremely large code bases. The larger the code base, the more likely of a security bug. Some of these bugs may have security implications. So to give you an example, when your friend sends you a file and it tells you that, you know, this is the latest photograph which I took in Singapore, when you try to open it, and if the application copies all your data from your hard disk and sends it to somebody on the internet, that probably is a security bug, right? So you open the file, you assume that, you know, you are seeing something else, but the application behaves maliciously. It copies all the data, sends it to a random hacker on the internet, or, you know, it tries to get onto your machine and install some software, or, you know, it tries to steal your web banking password or something like that. That's probably a security bug. Some of these security bugs are bigger than other security bugs. So, you know, I just mentioned Shellshock or Heartbleed or something like that. These are big security bugs. And the reason they are big security bugs is the fact that, you know, they affect a lot of users on the internet, right? So I'm sure you've heard of, you know, as you mentioned earlier, you've heard of Heartbleed.
This is when most of the people started to notice these big issues in open source software. Heartbleed was a bug in OpenSSL. This bug was around for 10 years before it was actually found. The person who found it incidentally. So it was not like he was actually actively looking at this bug. He accidentally found it. It is said that it affected 60% of all web servers on the internet, right? Which is a very big amount, which is a very big number. 60% of all web servers. And some of these web servers are embedded, right? So, you know, we have this track on IoT and stuff like that, where you have the web server actually embedded onto the device. And there's really no way you can update the device, right? So the only update you can do is probably the firmware or something like that. But nobody really cares about updating the device, right? So 60% of all web servers, it led to a lot of widespread attacks on the internet. Scripts were available in which you can actually download the script and you can attack some web server. I read about a Canadian student who was like 16 years old, and he used Heartbleed to log in to his university web server, and he could download the credentials of all the students, and it took like 10 minutes or something like that, right? So if you've heard of shell shock, shell shock is a flaw in Bash, right? Bash is the most common shell which everybody uses. And when we were working on shell shock, we figured out a couple of things which were really shocking. The first thing which we figured out is a lot of set-top boxes. Yeah, right. Set-top boxes are these devices which you use to get cable TV and you can connect your set-top boxes to the television, right? A lot of set-top boxes use Bash, which is very, very strange, right? Because you would assume that, you know, you want a set-top box to download the signal, unscramble, and just send it to your TV and to see the movie or something. But a lot of set-top boxes use Bash, which is really annoying, right? So it so happened that Bash was used in set-top boxes so that the cable operator could send commands to the set-top box, and, you know, you could be subscribed to some channels or something like that. So that's why they use Bash on set-top boxes. If you've heard of NAS, network attached storage devices, they use Bash as well, right? NAS devices uses Bash as well. We even figured out that Android mobiles use Bash, right? So when you go to a conference, when you connect to the internet, and if there's a malicious AP in the conference, it is possible that the malicious AP may execute code on your Android phone, right? So right now, when you come to FOSSASIA, you connect to the access point. If I set up a malicious AP, I could actually run code on your phone. I can see what data is on your phone. I can see what images you have. I can see what transactions you are doing on your internet banking website, which is really scary, right? If you've heard of Ghost, I doubt if you've heard of Ghost. This is a flaw in glibc get-host by name. So glibc is one open source library which is used everywhere. All applications on your Linux and your Unix box, and probably on your mobile as well, they're compiled against this library called glibc, and the list goes on. I could actually spend hours talking about them. If you have heard of Logjam, or if you have heard of Slot, or all of these are big vulnerabilities which were found in open source software, right? So why are we doing this? So there is a famous cryptographer called Bruce Schneier. I'm not sure if you've heard of his name. He coined a word called the security circus, right? And the security circus basically means four things. The first thing is, whenever an open source, whenever a big flaw is found, the person who finds the flaw, he wants to make himself as famous as he can, right? So if I find a flaw in OpenSSL and I want to earn instant fame, what I do is I go to the media and I tell the media that next week I'm going to disclose a flaw in OpenSSL, and that flaw is going to affect everyone on the internet, and we all are doomed, and we should go and live in a cave, right? So that's basically what happened. In case of Ghost, the person who found the vulnerability, he was a French guy. He actually went to the French media, and he told him that if you want big money, then next week I am going to disclose a flaw which is going to affect all internet servers on the internet which use an open source operating system. And what they basically did was, they made a press review, they wrote a press statement, and they were working on a lot of hype. And suddenly, the only mistake which they made was, they sent one of these emails on the internet, and the email was in French. And somebody from our team, he figured out the email, we translated it. And that is how we came to know that this guy is planning a big media hype, right? So this is going to happen. So what Bruce Schneier basically says, that in a security circus, the first thing which happens is there is media hype. because there is media hype, the companies which provide this open source software, they are forced to have emergency updates. Because they are emergency updates, we really don't have the time to test all of these. The customers panic a lot because, you know, if I have 10,000 or 1 lakh machines on the internet, which are serving an e-commerce website, and my website is affected, I really want it to be patched as fast as I can. So who benefits from that? The only person who really benefits is the person who actually did the hype. He found a flaw and he really wants to become famous overnight. So why open source? Why all of these flaws are targeted against open source? I'm sure you have never heard of a Heartbleed in Windows, or you have never heard of a shell shock in Android or something like that. So why is open source being targeted right now? All of these flaws, they want to target open source or open internet protocols, right? So I'm going to compare internet protocols with open source because they are open out there. They are written in plain text. There is an RFC and things like that. Which leads a lot of interesting questions. The first question is open source really secure? If you count on your fingers, in the last 2 years, we have had like 14 big flaws. And if you compare that with Windows, there's like none. So is open source really secure? That's a big question which comes to us. The second question which comes to us is open source easy target to attackers and hackers? That's the next big question which comes to us. And last but not least, should we still continue to use open source, or, you know, should these big enterprises like you have Red Hat, or, you know, you have other big enterprises, should these enterprises continue to use open source? And I'm trying to give a few answers to these questions. Closed source software has equal number of bugs. That's the first thing which I'm going to say. My first statement, all software has bugs. Bigger the software, bigger the bugs. So my first statement is, I'm sure closed source software has equal number of bugs. In fact, there was a research which was conducted in which, so all these security advisories which Microsoft tries to issue every Tuesday. So if you have ever heard of Patch Tuesday is the Tuesday of the month where Microsoft will issue security advisories. And Patch Tuesday is the day in which no system administrator working on a Microsoft operating system is allowed to take a PTO. So you cannot take a leave on Patch Tuesday because you have to be ready to patch as soon as Microsoft comes out with the updates, right? So there was a research which was recently conducted, and they tried to figure out what all security fixes are fixed by Microsoft on a Patch Tuesday. And they took all the open source fixes for the entire month. And they figured out, actually, Microsoft fixes more security issues than open source, which does not really mean that they are more secure. It really means that more issues have been found. So there's a really interesting story. And I'm not sure if I have the time, but, you know, I'll try to make it really, really quick. There was this Microsoft guy, and I don't want to take his name. What he used to do is, he used to go to conferences, he used to go to customers, and he used to have two glass bowls, and he used to bring a bag of jelly beans, right? And what he used to do is, he used to take the first jelly bean, and he used to say that this jelly bean is for this particular security issue found in an open source software, say that had Linux or something like that. And he used to drop the jelly bean in the bowl, right? And then he used to take one more jelly bean, and he used to say, this is for this particular security flaw found in Microsoft Windows 2000 or 98 or whatever, and he used to drop in the bowl. And he used to keep on doing that. And at the end of that, the bowl which contained open source was full, and the bowl which contained the Microsoft, which represented Microsoft, had like 5 jelly beans or 10 jelly beans. And by doing that, he wanted to prove to people that open source is less secure. We talked with him, a lot of open source people talked with him, and we tried to put it across him that when Microsoft says that in this Patch Tuesday, Microsoft is going to fix MSFA 2012 and some random number, they are not really telling us how many security flaws they have found. Right, they are just telling us, we are fixing security flaws with Internet Explorer. Does Microsoft care to tell you that what flaws have been found, on what part of the software the flaws have been found, how many CVE IDs, which are numbers assigned to security flaws, have been addressed? So if Microsoft wants to tell us how many security flaws they have found, or how many security flaws they have fixed with all of these security updates, only then his demonstration is correct. Because when you find a security flaw with, say, Mozilla Firefox, Mozilla will tell you that we have found this one security flaw. This flaw is in this patch or a part of the software. Here is the open source patch. You can actually go and verify the patch yourself. And with this particular update, we are going to fix this patch. None of the closed source companies have this kind of transparency. So, as I said, companies hide details about these flaws. One update can actually theoretically address 100 issues. It can even address 1,000 issues. Nobody really knows. Open source makes it easy to find bugs. Why? Because the code is out there. If you know programming, if you know C, if you know some other language, you're free to download with some amount of expertise, with some amount of time. You're free to look into the code and you can find bugs. How do you do that with closed source? You need to buy a software called Era Pro, which is like $5,000 USD, last I checked. You buy that, you run your binary through the software, and you will get the disassembly. And probably if you study assembly language for 5 years or something like that, you may be able to figure out what they're actually trying to do. Plus, they try to obfuscate things intentionally so that you cannot disassemble. And last but not least, it is illegal to disassemble their software. So, when you install Microsoft 2000 or something, and when you just clicked on I agree, one of the clauses which says is, it is illegal to disassemble our software, right? Which is mostly good. So open source, having the source out there, has got a disadvantage as well. It is easy for people to read and find bugs, but it is mostly good because everybody will generally benefit from the peer review out there. This generally leads to more peer review, which means more security in most cases, right? So the quick answer is that the security circus basically shows that open source projects are resilient to these kind of big flaws. It is possible to quickly patch these flaws. It is possible to quickly send these updates to the customers or the consumers of these softwares, and they can, as compared with the closed source counterpart who just keep shoving things inside the carpet and say we will fix it. I reported a bug with Microsoft 2000, if I remember, in 2001 or something like that, 2001 or 2002, I don't remember. They still won't tell me when that particular bug is going to be fixed. And I think Windows 2000 is end of line or something like that, last I checked. So it was like, say, 13 years ago, right? So this is the kind of response which they have. They keep on shoving things inside the carpet. They keep on telling me that we are working on it. And probably sometime they'll tell me that we won't fix this flaw because Windows 2000 is end of line or something like that. I've not checked if it is. One more advantage of open source, users can react faster, right? So the flaw is out there on the internet. There is media hype. Everybody is trying to talk about it. You need to react now. You need to make sure you install the latest version from your vendor or you download from the internet. The vendors are under pressure as well, right? So if I find a flaw with OpenSSL, I tell OpenSSL, I found this big flaw. If you don't disclose in 1 week, I'm going to go out and disclose it myself. So the vendor is under a lot of pressure to patch as well. As compared with that, if I go and tell that to my Microsoft, probably Microsoft will tell me, go ahead. Like it doesn't really care. I think I've probably reached at the end of my... And in conclusion, open is secure. And if you have some questions, I think we have some time.
So how can one say a newbie or someone who just started contributing to free software can actually join in any of these security groups? If someone has interest about security, how can they actually start learning about it? There is always a start, correct?
Yeah. So are you talking about having a career in security?
But more about having contribution to these teams. Like if someone is interested about some project, and then say like they want to learn about how can they help you guys.
Okay. I think the usual process would follow, which is true for any contributing to any open source. Like get on a mailing list, see what part of the project you are interested in. First, try to understand what the code base really is.
So understanding code base is important.
Right? It's kind of important, because if you want to contribute positively to the security of that product, you need to know at least a little bit about the code base. Read the security flaws. A lot of these security flaws are open out there. Like, you know, Mozilla. Mozilla has a policy in which once the security flaw is fixed, they will open up the security flaw. So you can actually go to the bug, you can read about it, and you can see, you know, what analysis has been done. So that's probably a starting point. A lot of these security groups have a high threshold to get into it, because, like, you know, there's a trust involved. So if you really want to get into the security group, you need to prove yourself worthwhile of it. So there's a high threshold of getting into that particular group. But, you know, once you've started to contribute really good, probably most of the people in the project will feel that, you know, you should be put into that group. Yes?
I have a question. Thank you for the talk, firstly. My question is with regards to, I'm not sure if you heard about the Linux Mint backdooring. They actually managed to push that had the backdoor inside, mm-hmm. and was not on the real side. So, how does the open source community reconcile this? These
backdoors
don't continue to be snuck in for whatever reason.
Yeah. So before I answer your question, we get a lot of queries from customers. So because I work for the Red Hat security team, there are a lot of customers who come and tell us that, you know, the system has been backdoored. And, you know, is this because there is a flaw in your operating system that our system has been backdoored? And for 99% of Red Hat run systems, we have figured out that they are probably running a web panel or something like that, which allows people to log into the FTP sites. And they have either their web panel has got a simple password, or they have an open SSH port which is open, which has got a very simple password, like, you know, Red Hat 123 or something like that. So most of the cases, the backdooring is because your system is not configured correctly. I'm not sure what the Mint Linux backdoor is. But another way of backdooring is somebody spins up a malicious package, and he's able to push onto a repository. And when a person downloads it from the repository, he has a backdoor package. So a very good example of that, if you have ever heard of VSFTPD, have you heard of VSFTPD? Very secure FTPD, right? A long time back, somebody got onto the repository where VSFTPD is, and they backdoored it. And the backdoor was very interesting. When you log into FTP, you need to enter your username. So if you put your username as anonymous, and if you put your password as a smiley, it will allow you to immediately get onto the FTP server. So that was a backdoor which they put. And the creator of VSFTPD figured out what the backdoor was, that it was backdoored, because the hacker made a mistake. The hacker compiled object files, and he put the object files into the tarball, which increased the size of the tarball. Then the creator realized that all his updates need to be signed. Right, so, you know, if you can do something like that, if you can sign all your packages, plus, you know, if you are downloading packages from the Mint repository, if you can verify that the signatures have been signed, that the signatures on the packages are correct, then probably, you know, that's one way to avoid backdoor. But then that again brings a very important question. If there's an insider inside Mint Linux, and if he has access to the signing process, then the whole thing is lost, right? So that's what my previous speaker was talking about. He wanted to talk about the web of trust. As in, you know, you need to trust someone at the end of this whole thing. Does that answer your question?
Because
I'm sorry if the answer was a little bit long.
The Mint backdoor, I think it was packaged with the operating system.
So yeah, but someone signed the package, right? Yeah.
So yeah. How does the open source community
prevent that? I think one thing you can do is you can figure out who put the backdoor in, and you can kind of ban him for life or something like that.
If I were to add this one a little bit, there would be some years ago the kernel.org was compromised because somebody's machine, some core developer with a commit rights got compromised for some reason, and therefore the whole thing just propagated. So these things are not about open source in and of itself. It's about people, it's about process. It's, you know, the quite a new word, the DevOps part of the story. And if you're not clean in how you do stuff, you don't just put random, you know, thumb drives and stick into your system that you do work with. So that's where flaws can happen. Right?
The very basic information is never invent your own cryptography. Please trust the people who actually does that and use whatever they suggest. But never think that the algorithm or the new thing you discovered will be able to help everyone.
Yeah.
And And just as a final thought, okay, kernel.org went offline for, I think it was 3 months. 3 months or 4 months, I forget when, how long it was. To recover and bring the system back to a pristine, more good state. So you might as well go offline, fix it, and then come back in, and then make sure you fix the process along the way.
The Fedora project
was compromised as well. Most of these compromises happened because of human mistakes. The guy who had commit access on Fedora, he was trying to log into Fedora servers from one of his own servers, and his public key was on his own server. Right, so he was trying to SSH to Fedora servers from his server where his private key was, and his server where the private key was compromised. So once your server is compromised, you can use that private key and you can hop into the Fedora infrastructure and you can do a lot of mess. The bad thing about that was his private key was not protected by a password. You can protect your private key by a password, which he did not. And people and the hacker hopped into the Fedora system. We were actually able to observe him. So when the hacker hopped into the Fedora system, we were on that system and we were able to observe what he is doing. And he managed to create a backdoor OpenSSH package, right? But he could not sign the package. Because the problem with signing is we have a hardware which does the signing. And you really need to have deeper credentials to actually sign. So he created a backdoor package, but he could not sign because we have an HSM on the backend which does the actual signing process. But of course, there was a press release. So if you go to internet, it's there. There was a press release, and we even made a script and we published a script on the internet saying that if you have an OpenSSH package, please download this script, and this script will check if you are using the backdoor package. I am not aware if anybody actually installed the backdoor package, because once more, this signing process is quite important because it actually tells that you know, we trust this particular thing. But I'm sure it could happen with any infrastructure. So you know, there is a weak link, which you know the hacker can get into the infrastructure and do stuff like that.
That's always the human.
Yes.
That's a very interesting point that you made about HSMs. I don't know much about HSMs, but I sort of know that it can form an essential part. Now, if you're not someone with the resources of Fedora, mm-hmm. How is there a poor man's version of HSM?
There should be, I think.
YubiKey would be a good one for swiping.
Okay. Yeah. A lot of people use a disconnected machine to sign packages. Like, you know, I have a laptop with me, and I have the private and the public key on this laptop.
Okay.
I use this as a primary signing machine. I don't connect to the internet.
Right.
And what I do is when I want to sign a package, I put it on a USB or something like that, bring this over here, mm-hmm. sign it, transfer the signed package back to the USB, and you know, take it back. So basically disconnected from the internet.
Okay.
In a secure location as well. So you know, if I keep on roaming around with my laptop, it's not going to help. So physical security is extremely important. So this is kind of a poor man's version. It does not have to be a virtual machine, because virtual machines can be stolen.
Yeah.
That it needs to be on a physical machine, which is at a secure location,
yeah.
And definitely not on the network.
Right. Raspberry Pis,
They will do, yes. Yes.
I'm not sure if there's an issue with the random number generator. Or something to that effect.
You need to generate your keys only once.
Okay.
Right. The whole signing process. So you generate your key on a real system which has got a real good source of entropy,
okay.
And then you can transfer your public and private keys onto the signing machine,
okay.
which you can use as a source to sign your packages. So keys need not be generated on Raspberry Pi, and they have to be done only once.
Okay.
So if you have a good source of entropy, you can generate a big key,
mm-hmm.
copy it to Raspberry Pi, and use it as your primary machine to sign stuff.
Okay. Let's go. We were thinking of setting up a Raspberry Pi as an automatic signing device.
Automatic, as in?
Well, it's in the safe, right?
Okay.
So then we bring it out. The plugs in the USB.
Yeah.
Signs it.
Yeah.
It out.
Just make sure when you plug in onto the USB, it's not on the network.
Yeah. Okay.
And you need a backup copy of your private key.
Yeah.
So because if something happens, then you know you're kind of gone. So we have a backup copy of our private key at multiple locations.
Mm.
So you know, there's one in APEC, one in EMEA, one in US. So you know, if you get hit by an earthquake or something like that, you still have your backup.
Right. Okay.
You can go to this shop called Cardinal Concepts.
Yeah.
And they have hardware tokens within like $50 range,
right,
which cannot be tampered.
Yeah.
So you have to check in physical location and security of the hardware tokens.
Yeah, but can those hardware token sign?
Yes, so
they can sign?
Yeah, you can use it directly on the Fedora boxes or Linux systems.
Okay.
Without any problem.
So you can have your private key. You can have your private key on the token and you use the token to sign?
Sign, yes. And it cannot be completely tamperable.
Okay.
The only problem is that make sure you buy more than one if anything happens to the key. Like
yeah, because most HSMs would generate the key themselves.
Yes.
So you can use HSM to generate the key, and it's impossible to extract the private key from the HSM.
And these are very cheap.
Yeah.
So, but the only problem, yeah, even in Singapore, so you can import them.
I think that's all the time we have for questions. So thank you very much for the great talk.
Thank you.